Câteva amintiri despre domnul Sergiu Gelac, primul ministru de externe al României după evenimentele din 1989. Salut, sunt Marincean Ioan și sunt voluntar în proiectul My Story.
Poza este a ultimei întâlniri comune, cred că și prima în definitiv, a ministrilor de externe de atunci ai NATO și ai tratatului de la Varșovia, care a avut loc la Ottawa în februarie 1990 cu ocazia conferinței Cerului Deschis. Și pot fi recunoscuți Jim Baker, secretarul de stat al Statelor Unite, Eduard Shevardnadze, ministrul de externe al Uniunii Sovietice pe vremea aia, Douglas Hurd, ministrul de externe al Marii Britanii, Roland Dumas, ministrul de externe al Franței, Gyula Horn, viitorul prim-ministru maghiar, la vremea aia ministrul de externe, primul ministru și ministrul de externe ai Canadei, Hans-Dieter Genscher, din profesorul Skubiszewski, din Sudea Externe al Poloniei. Cu această ocazie a avut loc și o ședință separată, închisă, a ministrilor de externe din Tratatul de la Varșovia. Când mi s-a pus în vedere că următoarea ședință a Comitetului Politic Consultativ al Tratatului de la Varșovia trebuie să aibă loc la București. Și am invocat considerente logistice, dar și de dispoziție generală a publicului român, care nu prea înțelege și nici nu are stomac pentru așa ceva. Și am declinat această onoare, lucru care a stârnit o oarecare surpriză din partea colegilor, dar s-a oferit atunci Gyula Horn să găzduiască următoarea reuniune la Budapesta, ceea ce s-a și întâmplat. Early childhood was spent in a forest. Some people say that it still shows. That is because my father was a forest ranger, my mother a teacher of Latin, and I have therefore developed an understanding and a love of natural things from early childhood. My family roots are in the former Romanian province of Bessarabia, where my father and mother family live. But I was born and raised and educated in Romania. I graduated from the Bucharest University School of Languages and joined the Foreign Service as a junior clerk in 1961. Thereafter, I went through a normal diplomatic career from attaché to counselor in 72 and held mid-level executive positions mainly in policy planning and multilateral diplomacy. All in all, I attended some 16 sessions of the United Nations General Assembly, but I started first in the early 60s at the Committee on Disarmament in Geneva. So everything promised a normal and uneventful career in a job that I liked and found exciting and rewarding. Obviously, the first impulse to become a diplomat was a childish and superficial one. I was impressed by the panache of the diplomatic life, the fact that you are supposed to wear a top hat and to walk around in dinner jackets and tails and morning dress. That was impressive. And also the opportunity from early readings of diplomatic memoirs and history. The exposure to opportunities to meet interesting and remarkable people. My disenchantment with the communist system was not a sudden revelation. It was a creeping process which lasted for many years. And even after I was eventually fired from the civil service in 1978, it took me probably more than 5 years to become a more or less free person in a very unfree society at the time. I remember that when I was mercifully fired, I went out in the streets of Bucharest and whenever I met a friend or an acquaintance, I reintroduced myself. I'm Sergiu Celac, a free person. And it was presumptuous and untrue. Because as I said, getting the system out of my system takes years. And that accounts for the confusion of a very complicated and sometimes painful transition of Romania to normalcy, to normality, to market economy and democracy as we know it. For 11 years, I had an opportunity to discover humanity in the people around me and in myself to a certain extent. I worked as a lowly editor in a publishing house. I discovered the delight of being normal. Until then, I was just another bureaucrat in a very rigidly established and hierarchical communist bureaucracy. Then, after years in which I made a living by translating mostly poetry, but also fiction and non-fiction, but probably the most lucrative ways of keeping alive in those days was dubbing films. I translated and actually acted in Romanian films translated into English with a team of brilliant enthusiasts. And also, I made a bit of a name for myself at that time by writing lyrics in English for pop music. That sounds maybe a little unusual for a future Minister of Foreign Affairs, but that's life. Then a revolution happened in my country, which was a long time coming, but the explosion was sudden, violent and confusing. I was not engaged in any major conspiracy. I was just being critical like everybody else. And when people asked me about my personal role in the events of December 89, I described my participation in those events as being masses. I was one of the masses, shouting my head off in the various hot points of the city of Bucharest. And 2 days later I was called and not offered, but rather ordered to become foreign minister in the first post-communist government. Probably the fact that I was closer to the decision making, albeit in a very minor junior executive capacity, helped me understand better that there was something wrong right there at the top. What actually triggered it was the fact that I, in addition to my own doubts and what I picked up from friends, especially in the intellectual community, fellow writers, probably one of the major influences was that of my brother-in-law, a brilliant mathematician who eventually emigrated to the United States and later, after the changes in Romania, became Romania's ambassador to Washington. We wrote several pieces together on the theory and practice of international relations. And one of them was about the theory of rational decision making. And it has a very convoluted title in order to disguise the substance. Something like cooperative management of force-induced international situations. We moved the debate from domestic politics in Romania to the international scene, but the message was clear. Because the message was that the whole paper was half of it was text, which I read, and half of it was written in mathematical formulae, which he read. And what we couldn't say in words, he said in mathematical symbols. And the whole message was very simple. The more participants in a decision-making process, the better the chance of a rational decision at the end of the process. With the reversal, that the less participants, the less likelihood of rationality in the final decision. With the extreme case of decision-making by one, which guarantees irrationality in final decision-making. The problem apparently was that at that time, of course, we couldn't publish in any Western publication, in any overseas publication, not even in Bulgaria, without a certain procedure and certification. But there was an exception. If the paper was presented at one of the sessions of the Romanian Academy of Sciences, which I did. And therefore, we published that in not very popular American periodical World Futures and Technological Forecasting, for which the Romanian secret police did not have the money to buy or to make to subscribe to that publication, but it was apparently transmitted by their colleagues from the KGB directly in the exchanges of information. And therefore, we both, the mathematician Mihai Botez and myself, got quickly fired. He was sent to a statistical division in the delta of the Danube. My fate was more merciful. I was moved to a publishing house. But because I served as an interpreter for a succession of Romanian leaders, some 5 years before Ceaușescu came to power, I used to translate for Gheorghiu Dej, for Prime Minister Maurer and others. And because the combination was a bit unusual, I was interpreter for English and for Russian as well. So I attended the Warsaw Pact meeting in small committee and the Comic-Con meetings, which were attended only by the secretaries general of the communist parties and the communist bloc. But also meetings with American presidents and other leaders. It was natural that they should keep an eye on me because I had access to some things that were almost dangerously secret at the time. So I sort of suspected that, especially after I got fired, and it happened in 78, on against the background of paranoia and fear in the top echelons of the communist authorities in Romania, because the closest advisor and chief of security and external intelligence defected to the United States. So most of the people in the immediate entourage were removed. But in our case, it was a more drastic, but not violent removal. I suspected, of course, that I was being followed, and I was under some sort of surveillance. But the person who actually discovered how it worked was my wife. I was somewhere in the mountains enjoying a vacation with a writer and screenwriter friend of mine. And the only keys to the apartment were my wife's. She was a school teacher. She came home from the school. Everybody else, the first trip was to the bathroom. And she discovered that the cover on the toilet was raised. First she thought I had come back home. But then she realized that people could enter with no problem in our apartment. So 2 days after the After I was appointed minister in the new post communist government, I had the visit of a very formal general, the commander of the communication forces of the army, General Cherbu, accompanied by a team of experts with suitcases of sophisticated equipment, who asked me that to, or permission to sweep the office, the ministerial office, which was known to have been bugged by the Securitate before, especially on orders from Mrs. Ceaușescu, who was more curious about the goings on in those inner offices in particular. So I said, do your duty, of course, but take time, go to my place, because my wife is nervous about microphones. Here at the ministry, for at least a month or so, we are not going to have secrets. We have to work in the open because everybody is watching. And there will be leaks in whatever we do. But at home, well, that's different. That's my wife cares, so I care. Please. And he returned after a couple of hours with a bunch of microphones. You can have a look at the work of art, because I asked the general to give me at least a couple of those microphones. They were embedded in the wall behind the plaza, so it's impossible to discover. One was even placed in the sink in the kitchen. Because not that we took special precaution, but we knew that if you put the radio on and let the water run from the faucet, you are not likely to be overheard. But quite frankly, we didn't have any discussions which would have required such precautions. And I asked for two pieces in order to mount them in a work of art. I asked one of my artists friend to produce a work of art, a symbol of those times. And the general was at first reluctant because he told me that they were Japanese made and very expensive. And so what about the problem? Well, what is the use? Now we have freedom, we have democracy. They might come in handy some days. But he still gave me two. And they were mounted by a friend of mine, a brilliant black and white artist and painter, who did some, at least 50 covers for the New Yorker magazine, and he was on the staff of the New York Times as an illustrator. And he kindly produce such a work of art, which has a symbolism of its own. It is a box. The symbol is that we lived as if in a box, behind a glass partition. And in the middle of the painting, there is a partition, indicating that people who listened to us, little mortals, could listen through the walls. And the whole painting is executed with materials of the sea. There is an emaciated figure of the victim, presumably myself. The head is a seashell, and the body is painted with sea sand over some sort of glue. And some bones corroded by the sea, picked up from the sea. And in the upper left corner, You have the two microphones, which are authentic pieces. There were not so many people, after all, who were subject to that sort of surveillance. And probably, now with the hindsight of wisdom, after two decades, I would even speculate that those listening devices and other surveillance that I was subject to in those times may have actually saved my life. Because what they were after was not whether we talk unkindly about the valiant leadership of the Communist Party, Ceausescu and his wife, but rather whether I was a traitor to the country, in whatever sense. And there is a fundamental one sense, that the notion of treason is not really ideological. It belongs to one of the possible flaws of human nature, which may cause irreparable distortions. And the fundamental conclusion from the interpretation of the various distortions that can happen is the ability to trust people. That is why I was not curious to have a look at my dossier, surveillance dossier in the archives. Because I still want to preserve at least a rudiment of hope in the innate purity of human nature. I don't want to be disappointed by recognizing that some of my best friends were actually reporting anything of me. So I simply prefer not to know. And I'm much more comfortable in the notion that I may be deceiving myself, but I don't actually know who and for what reason betrayed me in those days.